Welcome to New Zion Assembly. A New Testament digital online home church for true Israelites. Our teaching presbyter is Rick Wiles. Our preaching presbyter is Doc Burkhart. Now, let's join the online service where we worship the King of true Israel, Jesus Christ.
Hello, dear brethren. Welcome to New Zion Assembly. I'm Rick Wiles. We're so glad to have our brothers and sisters here with us. Brothers and sisters in Christ, regardless of where you live in the world, we're here in Vero Beach, Florida, but because of technology and the worldwide internet, we are able to be together. You may be in Europe or Australia or Africa or the Caribbean or Canada, but we are here together, one body, one faith, one spirit, one church, and that is a blessing for all of us. Now, Dr. Raymond Burkhart will be here later in the service. We call him Dr. Doc Burkhart, but he does have a doctorate degree, and he also has an anointed message for today's service. As always, we will participate in the Lord's Supper. So, if you would like to join into Holy Communion with the Lord Jesus Christ and your fellow brothers and sisters, please have bread and your choice of grape juice or red wine. Please have it available later in the service, and you and your family. We ask that the communion be restricted to those who are baptized, born again and baptized into Christ's church. If you're not born again, and if you call yourself a Christian and you haven't been baptized, then we ask you not to participate in Holy Communion. If you're not baptized, you need to get it done. Get yourself baptized. If you're not here in Florida, if you're out somewhere far away from us, please find a Bible-believing pastor in your town who will baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, let us begin our worship of our King, Jesus Christ.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, and let our minds be renewed by your word, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Now hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says about the greatest commandments in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment." Jesus said, "The second is just like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said, "On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets."
Our Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. The voice said, "Cry," and he said, "What shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. O Zion, that bringest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain. O Jerusalem, that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with thy strength. Lift it up, be not afraid. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm, and carry them in his bosom, and shall gently lead those that are with young. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. He is risen. He is risen, and he reigns forevermore. He is risen, he is risen. Come on and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. Celebrate, celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. He is risen, he is risen, and he reigns forevermore. Celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. He is risen, he is risen, and he reigns forevermore. Celebrate, come on, celebrate, come on, celebrate, come on, celebrate the resurrection of our Lord.
Our New Testament reading is from Matthew 1:18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call him his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Welcome to this week's message of New Zion Assembly, a digital online New Covenant congregation for true Israelites, the body of Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the opportunity once again, Lord, to share the Word of God with people around the world. The body of Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for the opportunity once again, Lord, to share the Word of God with people around the world in the form of video and audio. Lord, we ask that the anointing of the Holy Spirit would be on this message today as we talk about the wisdom of God and the foolishness of man. Lord, we invite the Holy Spirit to speak to us and to let the Word of God take root in our hearts as inspired by the Holy Spirit. Anoint these lips and anoint ears to the world in the form of video and audio. Lord, we ask that the anointing of the Holy Spirit would be on this message today as we talk about the wisdom of God and the foolishness of man. Lord, we invite the Holy Spirit to hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Our message this week focuses on a parable that many are familiar with. It is the story that Jesus told of two builders, one wise and the other foolish. And this parable is one that I come back to on a regular basis because I'm compelled to study the foolish in the Bible. I never want to be classified as a fool, and so this has been a long-term fascinating study in the characteristic of who the Bible calls fools. Now, in our passage today, we will focus on scripture that has Jesus talking about the most basic characteristic of fools. Now, first, let's look at the scripture. It's found in Matthew chapter 7, beginning at verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your to speak to us and to let the word of God take root in our hearts as inspired by the Holy Spirit? Anoint these lips and anoint ears to hear. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Our message this week focuses on a parable that many are familiar with. In your name, cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name. And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me. It is the story that Jesus told of two builders, one wise and the other foolish. And this parable is one that I come back to on a regular basis because I'm compelled to study the foolish in the Bible. I never want to be classified as a fool, and so this has been a long-term fascinating study in the characteristic of who you who practice lawlessness. Therefore, Whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock, who the Bible calls fools. Now, in our passage today, we will focus on scripture that has Jesus talking about the most basic character. The rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, and the flood characteristic of fools. Now, first, let's look at the scripture. It's found in Matthew chapter 7, beginning at verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me. Floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell. And great was its fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, you who practice lawlessness. Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. For he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Now, for most people, this is just a story of two men, one wise. The rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, and the flood. The other foolish, but in reality, this is a passage of scripture that is so rich in content that I don't even know if I can unfold everything in just one message on it. The floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching. Consider this as we begin, that the parable is referring back to the beginning of the passage where it talks about the qualifications of individuals to enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus himself makes a point beginning in verse number 21 that there will be those who call Jesus Lord, yet they will be unqualified, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Now, for most people, this is just a story of two men, one wise, the other foolish. But in reality, this is a passage of scripture that is so rich in content that I don't even know if I can unfold everything in just one message on it. Qualified for the kingdom of heaven. In fact, he goes out of his way to point out that it is not mere words that qualify you, but doing. Consider this as we begin, that the parable is referring back to the beginning of the passage where it talks about the qualifications of individuals to enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus himself makes a point beginning in verse number 21 that there will be those who call Jesus Lord, yet they will be unqualified. The will of the Father in heaven. Recognize this, that there are many that call Jesus Lord. In fact, this is what we teach. Don't just make Jesus your Savior, but make Him your Lord. But it's much deeper than that. In any kingdom, especially the kingdom of heaven, you may have those that give lip service to the King, but their loyalty is far from the throne. So our acceptance to the kingdom of heaven depends entirely on our qualified for the kingdom of heaven. In fact, he goes out of his way to point out that it is not mere words that qualify you, but doing the will of the Father in heaven. Recognize this, that there are many that call Jesus Lord. In fact, this is what we teach. Don't just make Jesus your Savior, but make Him your Lord. But it's much deeper than that. In any kingdom, especially the kingdom of heaven, you may have those that give lip service to the King. Loyalty to the King of Kings. Now, exactly how do we express our loyalty? By doing what the King says. In verse 22, even more is revealed. It says, first, but their loyalty is far from the throne. So our acceptance to the kingdom of heaven depends entirely on our loyalty to the King of Kings. Now, exactly how do we express our loyalty? By doing what the king says. In verse 22, even more is revealed. It says, first, many will say to me in that day. So who are the many? Well, they're the ones being judged by Jesus. Judged by who? Jesus himself. When? In that day, the day of reckoning, the day of judgment, what we refer to here in this ministry as the final day. Individuals will give an accounting for the words they say. Now, it appears that before the final judgment is set, you will have to meet Jesus face to face and speak up. Now, I need you to just forget the idea of meeting St. Peter at the old pearly gate, my friend, because we will be meeting Jesus himself. Now, before you get too excited and start shouting glory, look what happens next. Jesus himself. When? In that day, the day of reckoning, the day of judgment, what we refer to here in this ministry as, have we not prophesied in thy name? Have we not cast out devils in thy name? Have we not done many wonderful works in thy name? Wow, these people are awesome. They're out there prophesying. They're casting out devils. They're doing wonderful works, all in the name of Jesus as well. I wonder if they were doing seminars on prophesying. I wonder if they were having devil casting courses. I wonder if they were having wonderful works workshops. Jesus is apparently not impressed by this. He says, I never knew you, and I never will. What? How does this happen? How is it that the apparent works of God are being manifested in these lives, and yet Jesus never knew them? Now, that is just how powerful the name of Jesus is. Just the name of Jesus can create prophetic utterances. Just the name of Jesus can drive out the devil. Just the name of Jesus can manifest many wonderful works. And by the way, that phrase wonderful works in the Greek is that word dunamis, or power, where we get our word dynamite. It is also used in the same association with the power of the Holy Spirit, such as you shall receive the Holy Ghost and power. In other words, signs and wonders, many wonderful works, not one or a few only, but many, such as speaking in tongues, removing mountains, treading on serpents and scorpions, drinking any deadly thing without hurt, and healing all manner of diseases and sicknesses. Judas, for one, could plead all these things. He had the gift of preaching. He had a call from Christ to it, and yet became a castaway. Many people forget he had the power of casting out devils, and yet could not prevent the devil from entering him. Judas could perform miracles, do wonders in Christ's name, and yet at last was the betrayer of the Messiah himself. So these pleas and arguments will be of no use to the Lord Jesus, nor of any use to any at that great and final day. Now, it can be observed that these men lay the whole stress of their salvation upon what they have done in Christ's name and not on Christ himself, in whom there is salvation and in no other. But notice here that they say not a syllable of what Christ has done and suffered, but only what they have done. Indeed, these works are the greatest done among men. The gifts they had were the most excellent, accepting the grace of God. The works they did were of an extraordinary nature. Whence it follows that there can be no salvation, nor is it to be expected from any of these works. If preaching the word, which is attended with so much study, care, and labor, will not be a prevailing argument to admit men into the kingdom of heaven, how can it be thought that ever reading or hearing or any other external performance of religion should bring persons there as well? Understand something, my friend. The name of Jesus is powerful. It is so powerful. I believe that we take the name for granted much of the time. We need to understand that handling the name of Jesus should be like handling nitroglycerin. You know the old stories from America's West about the wagons that had to haul nitroglycerin in order to get to the mining camps? One wrong move, just one slip, just one sudden turn by the driver of the horses, and then boom, all that would be left would be a crater and some glycerin. You know the old stories from America's West about the wagons that had to haul nitroglycerin in order to get to the mining camps? Horseshoes. But in the right hands and under the right conditions, nitro is a very powerful tool. It can even be a weapon, such as in dynamite. One wrong move, just one slip, just one sudden turn by the driver of the horses, and then boom, all that would be left would be a crater and some hormite. But in the wrong hands, however, it is deadly. We need to understand the name of Jesus is power shoes. But in the right hands and under the right conditions, nitro is a very powerful tool. It can even be a weapon, such as in dynamite. Powerful and deadly. The wisdom of God, therefore, is knowing how to handle dynamite. All that would be left would be a crater and some hormite. But in the wrong hands, however, it is deadly. We need to understand the name of Jesus is power. So how do we handle the dynamite? How do we handle the nitro? By following the instructions laid out by the Father. And He gave us an instruction manual called the Word of God. Do you understand that the Word of God is the wisdom of God? It's our training manual. It's our instruction. Powerful and deadly. The wisdom of God, therefore, is knowing how to handle dynamite. Manual. James 1:22 says, "But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does." Of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. So going back to our original passage in Matthew chapter 7, back to verse 23, some things to point out to you. Horseshoes. But in the right hands and under the right conditions, nitro is a very powerful tool. It can even be a weapon, such as in dynamite. Jesus says, "I never knew you. Depart from me." Think about this. Not only does he not recognize you, but he also won't even acknowledge you. But in the wrong hands, however, it is deadly. We need to understand the name of Jesus is power. But in the wrong hands, however, it is deadly. We need to understand the name of Jesus is power. So going back to our original passage in Matthew chapter 7, back to verse 23, some things to point out to you. Powerful and deadly. The wisdom of God, therefore, is knowing how to handle dynamite. You will be evicted, run out of the entrance of the kingdom of heaven, and you will never know him. Powerful and deadly. The wisdom of God, therefore, is knowing how to handle dynamite. Oh, my friend, how sad it would be to go through our entire lives thinking that we had everything all lined up. I've got my reservation, yes. I've got my ticket on the railway to heaven, yes. I've got a cabin just over in the glory land, yes. But you will miss it all if you don't do what the great God has told you to do. Because, my friend, that is what it is all truly about. Following His instructions. He never knew you. There was never a relationship there. How sorrowful, how telling that one phrase, I never knew you. Many people today confess Christ. So how do we handle the dynamite? How do we handle the nitro? By following the instructions laid out by the Father. And He gave us an instruction manual called the Word of God. So how do we handle the dynamite? How do we handle the nitro? By following the instructions laid out by the Father. And He gave us an instruction manual called the Word of God. Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me. Think about this. Not only does He not recognize you, but He also won't even acknowledge you. Do you understand that the Word of God is the wisdom of God? It's our training manual. It's our instruction manual. James 1:22 says, but be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is... Do you understand that the Word of God is the wisdom of God? It's our training manual. It's our instruction manual. James 1:22 says, but be doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. They profess Christ. They wear the t-shirt. They've got the mug. They proudly show off the fish symbol or the bumper sticker. You. You will be evicted, run out of the entrance of the kingdom of heaven, and you will never know Him. A hearer of the Word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does. So going back to our original passage in Matthew chapter 7, back to verse 23, some things to point out to you. Jesus says, I never knew you, depart from me. Think about this. Not only does He not recognize you, but He also won't even acknowledge you. You will be evicted, run out of the entrance of the kingdom of heaven, and you will never know Him. Oh, my friend, how sad it would be to go through our entire lives thinking that we had everything all lined up. I've got my reservation, yes. I've got my ticket on the railway to heaven, yes. I've got a cabin just over in the glory land, yes. But you will miss it all if you don't do what the great God has told you to do. Because, my friend, that is what it is all truly about. Following His instructions. He never knew you. There was never a relationship there. But do you know Him? And more importantly, does He know you? Another thing that Jesus said, how sorrowful, how telling that one phrase, I never knew you. Many people today confess Christ. But in verse 23, He called all their prophesyings. They're casting out devils. They're many, many wonderful works. Jesus called those works iniquity. Iniquity, sin, a stench before Him. Utter refuse on the dung heap of eternity that'll burn forever. A complete loss. My friend, it is not enough to say. It is not enough to do. The only thing that truly, truly matters is do His will. Do His will. Verse 24, Jesus mentions these sayings of mine. So what exactly is Jesus saying? He is saying that His word, yes, His word, they profess Christ. They wear the t-shirt, they've got the mug, they proudly show off the fish symbol or the bumper sticker. But do you know Him? And more importantly, does He know you? Another thing that Jesus said in verse 23, He called all their prophesyings, their casting out devils, their many, many wonderful works. Jesus called those is equivalent to the will of the Father in heaven that we saw back in verse 21. Now, compare the two if you will. He also goes into the parable saying that those who follow the instructions, those works, iniquity. Iniquity, sin, a stench before Him. Utter refuse on the dung heap of eternity that will burn forever. A complete loss. My friend, it is not enough of Jesus. Those who do the will of the Father in heaven, which are one and the same, would be considered wise. Now, would it be great for Jesus to call you wise? So what are the characteristics of this wise man? Enough to say. It is not enough to do. The only thing that truly, truly matters is do His will. Well, let's think about it a minute. So He knew He needed shelter. He knew that there was coming a day that it would rain. He knew that there would be a flood. Now, would it be great for Jesus to call you wise? So what are the characteristics of this wise man? And that the winds would come and that he would take a beating. So what did he do? He prepared. Well, let's think about it a minute. So he knew he needed shelter. He knew that there was coming a day that it would rain. He knew that there would be a flood. Do His will. Verse 24, Jesus mentions these sayings of mine. Oh, my friend, how sad it would be to go through our entire lives thinking that we had everything all lined up and that the winds would come and that He would take a beating. So what did He do? He prepared. So what exactly is Jesus saying? He is saying that His word, yes, His word, how did He prepare? Well, first He found the right foundation, the rock. Now that's the wisest thing you can ever do right there. Is equivalent to the will of the Father in heaven that we saw back in verse 21. Now, compare the two if you will. He also goes into the parable saying that those who follow the instructions is equivalent to the will of the Father in heaven that we saw back in verse 21. Now, compare the two if you will. He also goes into the parable saying that those who follow the instructions of Jesus, those who do the will of the Father in heaven, which are one and the same, would be considered wise. How did He prepare? Well, first He found the right foundation, the rock. Now that's the wisest thing you can ever do right there. Now would it be great for Jesus to call you wise? So what are the characteristics of this wise man? Without the solid foundation of the rock, the rest of the work is just plain useless. Jesus says that the man who hears the word and does the work. Well, let's think about it a minute. So he knew he needed shelter. He knew that there was coming a day that it would rain. He knew that there would be a flood. Without the solid foundation of the rock, the rest of the work is just plain useless. Jesus says that the man who hears the word and does the word, and that the winds would come, and that he would take a beating. So what did he do? He prepared. The word is like a wise man that starts with the right foundation and uses the gifts and skills that the great God has invested. How did he prepare? Well, first he found the right foundation, the rock. Now that's the wisest thing you can ever do right there. The word is like a wise man that starts with the right foundation and uses the gifts and skills that the great God has invested. In him to build a house of shelter in this world. Notice now the foolish man. Now, without the solid foundation of the rock, the rest of the work is just plain useless. Jesus says that the man who hears the word and does the word is like a wise man that starts with the right foundation and uses the gifts and skills that the great God has invested. Couple things to point out. He was a builder just as the wise man. And the parable doesn't say that he was necessarily a worse builder than the first. So for the sake of the parable, let's just say that they are equally talented. He has some skills, obviously. In verse 27, we read that his house actually was pretty sturdy. After all, it survived the rains, still standing. It survived the floods, still standing. However, when the beatings came, that was enough. The house could take no more. Now, it was obviously interested in him to build a house of shelter in this world. Notice now the foolish man. Now, his house actually was pretty sturdy. After all, it survived the rains, still standing. It survived the floods, still standing. It survived the winds, still standing. However, when the beatings came, that was enough. The house could take no more. Now, it was obviously a well-built house, but it was destined to destruction from the very beginning because the foundation was made of sand. Couple things to point out. He was a builder just as the wise man. And the parable doesn't say that he was necessarily a worse builder than the first. You know, the people of this world have amazing talent and abilities. The technology. So for the sake of the parable, let's just say that they are equally talented. He has some skills, obviously. In verse 27, we read that we are seeing being developed in this day is astounding. There are so many things that man is capable of without the great God. Think of the buildings that we are seeing being developed in this day is astounding. There are so many things that man is capable of without the great God. Think of the buildings that his house actually was pretty sturdy. After all, it survived the rains, still standing. It survived the floods, still standing. It survived the winds, still standing. However, when the beatings came, that was enough. The house could take no more. Now, it was obviously man is made without God. Think of the accomplishments in space and beyond that man has made without God. Think of the technology that man has developed without God. Yes, there is this illusion that man and even some so-called Christians can do it all without God. Now, what do I mean about those in the church? Well, there's a movement afoot in the church today to control God. Any attempt to control divine power is idolatry and witchcraft. It survived the winds, still standing. However, when the beatings came, that was enough. The house could take no more. Now, it was obviously a well-built house, but it was destined to destruction from the very beginning because the foundation was made of sand. How? By thinking that we can get spiritual results by human means. For instance, if you use the right technique, then this will get you this result from God. If you put some money in God's casino, then you can expect this jackpot. If you follow the right rules from Scripture, then... You know, the people of this world have amazing talent and abilities. The technology you can command to obey your instructions. We are taking on the mantles of apostles that we are seeing being developed in this day is astounding. There are so many things that man is capable of without the great God. Think of the buildings man has made without God. Think of the accomplishments in space and beyond that man has made without God. Think of the technology, a well-built house, but it was destined to destruction from the very beginning because the foundation was made of sand. Technology that man has developed without God. Yes, there is this illusion that man and even souls and prophets in this day of age, and we don't know him. We're playing with nitro. We think that because the structure can survive, you know, the people of this world have amazing talent and abilities. The technology, some so-called Christians can do it all without God. Now, what do I mean about those in the church? Well, there's a movement afoot in the church today that we are seeing being developed in this day is astounding. There are so many things that man is capable of without the great God. Think of the buildings man has made without God. Think of the accomplishments in space and beyond that man has made without God. Think of the technology that it must somehow be blessed by God. My friend, it is going to rain and hard on believer and unbeliever alike. But the ones that will survive the beating will only be those that man has developed without God. Yes, there is this illusion that man and even to control God. Any attempt to control divine power is idolatry and witchcraft. Those with the sure foundation. Great was the fall. How tragic. It was a great house. Some so-called Christians can do it all without God. Now, what do I mean about those in the church? Well, there's a movement afoot in the church today. It was well built. A little house doesn't make a great fall. Only a great house makes a great fall. It fell into control God. Any attempt to control divine power is idolatry and witchcraft. How? By thinking that we can get spiritual results by human means. For instance, if you use the right technique, then this will get you this result from God. If you put some money in God's casino, then you can expect this jackpot. If you follow the right rules from Scripture, then great was the fall of it. It didn't just lean a little bit. It didn't just get a few shingles knocked off or turn over the flamingos in the front yard. It fell, and it was a great fall. You can command to obey your instructions. We are taking on the mantles of apostles. Do you now understand that anything outside the divine instruction of the great God is doomed to destruction? Doomed. It will fall. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but it will fall, and the fall is going to be great. How? By thinking that we can get spiritual results by human means. For instance, if you use the right technique, apostles and prophets in this day of age, and we don't know him. We're playing with nitro. We think that because the structure can survive, then this will get you this result from God. If you put some money in God's casino, then you can expect this jackpot. If you follow the right rules from Scripture, then great. I'm telling you now that I wish that this message was for the heathens, the pagans, and the sinners in the world. However, when I look at the mailing address on the you can command to obey your instructions.
We are taking on the mantles of apostles. The letter of this passage of Scripture, I'm faced with the sobering reality that Jesus is talking to those in the church. Yes, that it must somehow be blessed by God. My friend, it is going to rain and hard on believer and unbeliever alike. But the ones that will survive the beating will only be those, my friends, the world may gain something from this passage, but the letter wasn't addressed to them. It was addressed to those within the church who are refusing to follow the words of Christ. Sobering, isn't it? There were those in Jesus' day that heard these words for the very first time. And no doubt some of them were saying, that's not me. I'm a follower. I've been chasing Jesus. I've got my reservation, yes. I've got my ticket on the railway to heaven, yes. I've got a cabin just over in the glory land, yes. But you will miss it all if you don't do what the great God has told you to do. Because, my friend, that is what it is all truly about. Following His instructions. He never knew you. There was never a relationship there. It's around the countryside, on riverbanks, on mountains, out in gardens, just to hear Him preach, just to hear His words. But now, how sorrowful, how telling that one phrase, I never knew you. Many people today confess Christ. Jesus Himself is calling you, the believer, to obey. So what does that mean? It means we have to get out of this stupid... They profess Christ. They wear the t-shirt. They've got the mug. They proudly show off the fish symbol or the bumper sticker. Those with the sure foundation. Great was the fall. How tragic. It was a great house. It was an idiotic, dumbed-down Western mindset of entertainment Christianity, spectator Christianity, and start doing. But do you know Him? And more importantly, does He know you? Another thing that Jesus said was well built. A little house doesn't make a great fall. Only a great house makes a great fall. It fell. And what do? The will of the Father, the words that Jesus said. The last two verses of our passage are 10 and verse 23. He called all their prophesyings. They're casting out devils. Their many, many wonderful works. Jesus called those telling. In verse 28, it says, when Jesus finished, the people were astonished at His doctrine. It is doctrine, my friend. Great was the fall of it. It didn't just lean a little bit. It didn't just get a few shingles knocked off or turn over the flamingos in the front yard. It fell, and it was a great fall. Do you now understand that anything outside the divine instruction of the great God is doomed to destruction? Doomed. It will fall. Maybe not today. Maybe not tomorrow. But it will fall, and the fall is going to be great. It is pure teaching from the purest man. It's not merely good advice. It's not merely a suggestion. Great. I'm telling you now that I wish that this message was for the heathens, the pagans, and the sinners in the world. However, when I look at the mailing address on the post, works iniquity. Iniquity, sin, a stench before Him. Utter postal letter of this passage of Scripture, I'm faced with the sobering reality that Jesus is talking to those in the church. Yes, my friends, the world may gain something from this passage, but the letter wasn't addressed to them. It was addressed to those within the church who are refusing to find refuge on the dung heap of eternity that will burn forever. A complete loss. My friend, it is not enough to say. It is not enough to do. The only thing that truly, truly matters is do His will. Follow the words of Christ. Sobering, isn't it? There were those in Jesus' day that heard, do his will. Verse 24, Jesus mentions these sayings of mine, apostles and prophets in this day of age, and we don't know him. We're playing with nitro. We think that because the structure can survive. So what exactly is Jesus saying? He is saying that his word, yes, his word, these words for the very first time. And no doubt some of them were saying, that's not me. I'm a follower. I've been chasing Jesus. Is equivalent to the will of the Father in heaven that we saw back in verse 21. Now, compare the two, if you will. He also goes into the parable saying that those who follow the instructions around the countryside, on riverbanks, on mountains, out in gardens, just to hear him preach, just to hear his words, but now of Jesus, those who do the will of the Father in heaven, which are one and the same, would be considered wise. Now, would it be great for Jesus to call you wise? So what are the characteristics of this wise man? Well, let's think about it a minute. So he knew he needed shelter. He knew that there was coming a day that it would rain. He knew that there would be a flood. It's not just a great principle to live your best life now. It is doctrine, which means if we refuse it, we're refusing Jesus, and that the winds would come and that he would take a beating. So what did he do? He prepared. How did he prepare? Well, first he found the right foundation, the rock. Now that's the wisest thing you can ever do right there. Without the solid foundation of the rock, the rest of the work is just plain useless. Jesus says that the man who hears the word and does the word is himself. And I hate to break it to you, but if you can accept this doctrine of Jesus, then you really don't know him. And worse yet, he doesn't know you. Word is like a wise man that starts with the right foundation and uses the gifts and skills that the great God has invested. Now, doctrine is a tough word today. It is as hard for the modern pew populator to digest doctrine as it did in him to build a house of shelter in this world. Notice now the foolish man. Now, as it is to try to get a little kid to eat asparagus or spinach. Deuteronomy 32:2 says, my doctrine shall drop as the rain. Couple things to point out. He was a builder just as the wise man. And the parable doesn't say that he was necessarily a worse builder than the first. My speech shall distill as the dew, as the small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. So for the sake of the parable, let's just say that they are equally talented. He has some skills, obviously. In verse 27, we read, Jesus himself is calling you, the believer, to obey. So what does that mean? It means we have to get out of this stupid desire, the true doctrine, the didache of Christ. It only comes by intimacy with him. That his house actually was pretty sturdy. After all, it survived the rains, still standing. It survived the floods, still standing. Idiotic, dumbed down Western mindset of entertainment Christianity, spectator Christianity, and start doing. It survived the winds, still standing. However, when the beatings came, that was enough. The house could take no more. Now, it was obviously, what do we do? The will of the Father, the words that Jesus said. The last two verses of our passage are that it must somehow be blessed by God. My friend, it is going to rain and hard on believer and unbeliever alike. But the ones that will survive the beating will only be those telling. In verse 28, it says, when Jesus finished, the people were astonished at his doctrine. It is doctrine, my friend. It was with the sure foundation. Great was the fall. How tragic. It was a great house. It was well built. A little house doesn't make a great fall. Only a great house makes a great fall. It fell, and great was the fall of it. It didn't just lean a little bit. It didn't just get a few shingles knocked off or turn over the flamingos in the front yard. It fell, and it was a great fall. You have to love it, cherish it, seek it, caress it, hold it, and hold on to it. Verse 29, it says, he taught with authority. Understand this, however, he didn't just possess authority. He was the living embodiment of authority. Jesus says in Matthew 28:18, then Jesus came. Do you now understand that anything outside the divine instruction of the great God is doomed to destruction? He came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Heaven and earth, my friends, doomed. It will fall. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but it will fall, and the fall is going to be great. In verse 28, we see the scribes without authority. They have no authority because they are not known by Jesus. They're forgotten now and will eventually be forgotten forever. 1 John 4:17 says, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Listen, brother and sister, I'm telling you now that I wish that this message was for the heathens, the pagans, and the sinners in the world. However, when I look at the mailing address on the in Christ, we won't have to boast about our works on that day. We won't have to give the Lord the number of devils that we've cast out. And we won't have to be proud of our many wonderful works. Postal letter of this passage of Scripture, I'm faced with the sobering reality that Jesus is talking to those in the church. Yes, folks. Instead, in love, we'll be bold in humility in the day of judgment because we can be known by. My friends, the world may gain something from this passage, but the letter wasn't addressed to them. It was addressed to those within the church who are refusing to follow him. John 14:21 says, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him. Love seeks wisdom. Love seeks knowledge. Love seeks humility. And in closing, going back to verse 23, we hear that we need to know Jesus. But as we move on to verse 23, we see something different. Follow the words of Christ. Sobering, isn't it? There were those in Jesus' day that heard after people claimed to have done mighty works in his name, Jesus says that he will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Imagine that someone shows up at your front door asking to come in. He knows your name, your likes and dislikes, the cute things your kids or grandkids have done recently, where you went for vacation last year and more. But you don't recognize him. Would you let him in? Of course not. With Facebook and Twitter today, people can know a lot about us without any real relationship with us. In a similar way, our knowing things about Jesus forms no basis for entry into heaven. It hinges on his knowledge of us, on his relationship with us. Now note that Jesus does not point out to our having done the will of the Father here as he did earlier. Doing the Father's will is the proof that we are his. However, it is not the basis on which we are judged worthy of entering the kingdom of heaven. It is whether or not Jesus knows us that matters in that moment. Now taking a closer look, we find that those who do not enter the kingdom will be more than those invited in. This is a suggestion in verse 22, on that day, many will say to me, Moreover, we see it clearly stated a little earlier. It's around the countryside, on riverbanks, on mountains, out in gardens, just to hear him preach, just to hear his words. But now in verses 13 and 14, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. Those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. Jesus himself is calling you, the believer, to obey. So what does that mean? It means we have to get out of this stupid, idiotic, dumbed-down Western mindset of entertainment Christianity, spectator Christianity, and start doing. And those who find it are few. Since everything we've observed so far is true, we should take great notice. In fact, it should really... What do we do? The will of the Father, the words that Jesus said. The last two verses of our passage are telling. In verse 28, it says, when Jesus finished, the people were astonished at his doctrine. It is doctrine, my friend, terrifies. All this is easy to ignore right now because you're only with friends. But on that day, you'll face Jesus. It is pure teaching from the purest man. It's not merely good advice. It's not merely a suggestion. Jesus Christ himself. And there will be no ignoring it. We must address this now. Jesus will profess unto them, I never knew you. And that word translated profess here, it's not just a great principle to live your best life now. It is doctrine, which means if we refuse it, we're refusing Jesus himself. And I hate to break it to you, but if you can accept this doctrine of Jesus, then you really don't know him. And worse yet, he doesn't know you. Now, doctrine is a tough word today. It is as hard for the modern pew populator to digest doctrine as it is to try to get a little kid to eat asparagus or spinach. Deuteronomy 32:2 says, my doctrine shall drop as the rain. My speech shall distill as the dew, as the small rain upon the tender herb, and as the showers upon the grass. Do you desire the true doctrine, the didache of Christ? It only comes by intimacy with him. You have to love it, cherish it, seek it, caress it, hold it, and hold on to it. Verse 29, it says, he taught with authority. Understand this, however, he didn't just possess authority. He was the living embodiment of authority. Jesus says in Matthew 28:18, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Heaven and earth, my friends. In verse 28, we see the scribes without authority. They have no authority because they are not known by Jesus. They're forgotten now and will eventually be forgotten forever. 1 John 4:17 says, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. Listen, brother and sister in Christ, we won't have to boast about our works on that day. We won't have to give the Lord the number of devils that we've cast out. And we won't have to be proud of our many wonderful works. Instead, in love, we'll be bold in humility in the day of judgment because we can be known by him. John 14, 21 says, he that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him. Love seeks wisdom. Love seeks knowledge. Love seeks humility. And in closing, going back to verse 23, we hear that we need to know Jesus. But as we move on to verse 23, we see something different. After people claim to have done mighty works in his name, Jesus says that he will declared to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. Imagine that someone shows up at your front door asking to come in. He knows your name, your likes and dislikes, the cute things your kids or grandkids have done recently, where you went for vacation last year and more. But you don't recognize him. Would you let him in? Of course not. With Facebook and Twitter today, people can know a lot about us without any real relationship with us. In a similar way, our knowing things about Jesus forms no basis for entry into heaven. It hinges on his knowledge of us, on his relationship with us. Now note that Jesus does not point out to our having done the will of the Father here, as he did earlier. Doing the Father's will is the proof that we are his. However, it is not the basis on which we are judged worthy of entering the kingdom of heaven. It is whether or not Jesus knows us that matters in that moment. Now, taking a closer look, we find that those who do not enter the kingdom will be more than those invited in. This is a suggestion in verse 22. On that day, many will say to me. Moreover, we see it clearly stated a little earlier in verses 13 and 14, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. Those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. Since everything we've observed so far is true, we should take great notice. In fact, it should really terrify us. All this is easy to ignore right now because you're only with friends. But on that day, you'll face Jesus Christ himself, and there'll be no ignoring it. We must address this now. Jesus will profess unto them, I never knew you. And that word translated profess here is almost always translated confess. To confess is to say with, confess. When you confess your sins, you're saying with God that what you've done is sinful. He's not shocked or surprised. He's just glad that you're now saying it with him. Now, when Jesus confesses or says to a man that he doesn't know him, he will find that he already knew it. I don't think that they'll be frantically pleading his case thinking Jesus made a huge mistake. He'll know the truth of Jesus' words and their finality. God is merciful and gracious, and as the Bible says in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But on that day, his mercy will be only a memory. Jesus will say, depart from me. He won't be saying, I'll give you one last chance to turn and honor me as Lord. This means quite simply that now is the time. The last day, the day of judgment, the great and famous day fixed by the great God, unknown to angels and to men, which will be terrible to some, joyful to others, the day in which the faithful ministers of the gospel shall be owned by Christ and received into the kingdom of heaven. Many, not of the common people only, but of the preachers of the word, who have filled up the highest station in the church below. Not one or two or a few of them only, but many of them will say to me, to Christ, who will appear then as the judge of the quick and the dead, to which he is ordained by his Father. My friend, this is a sobering message today. I want to encourage you to make your hope and salvation sure, leaving nothing to doubt. I want you to rest in the full assurance that you're serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and that you fully understand that your Christ, your Savior, is a king right now. Make your confession of faith in the resurrection of Christ today. Repent, turn away, run from your sin, never to take it back up again. Be baptized, fully immersed in water in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in obedience to the Scriptures. And finally, go into all your world and tell everyone you know about that magnificent salvation that you have received. Thank you for tuning in. Please stay with us as we prepare to participate in the Lord's Supper, the communion. Please take the next few moments to gather in your own home with your family and have the elements of bread and the fruit of the vine ready to participate in the sacrament of faith, acknowledging our Lord's death until He comes again on that final day. Let's now prepare our hearts in worship with this hymn of praise.
I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger. He who believes in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father beckons. And I will raise him up. And I will raise him up. And I will raise him up on the last day. The bread that I shall give is my flesh for the life of the world. And if you eat of this bread, you shall live forever. Oh, you shall live forever. And I will raise you up. And I will raise you up. And I will raise you up on the last day.
Let us confess the symbol of our Christian faith in the ancient words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the only begotten, begotten of the Father before all ages, light of light, true God of true God, begotten, not made, of one essence with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became man. And he was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate, and suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church, I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
Let us pray for the universal church, the body of Christ our Lord. Almighty and eternal Heavenly Father, we humbly ask you in the name of Jesus Christ to receive our prayers and answer them according to your divine will and love. We ask that Christ's church worldwide will be one in the spirit of truth, unity, concord, and love, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity, peace, and godly love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that your Spirit will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness and guide and direct the leaders. We pray for our President, Joe Biden, and for Vice President Kamala Harris. We pray for President Biden's cabinet secretaries and advisors to give him wise counsel so that our nation may dwell in peace and safety. We also pray for House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, House Majority Leader Steny Hoyer, House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy, Senate Majority Leader Charles Schumer, and Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, and for all the members of the House and Senate. We pray for our judges and courts that they will decide matters according to your righteousness and wisdom. We pray for our military officers and members of the armed services that you will protect them as they guard our nation. Furthermore, we pray for our police officers who are your ministers of justice. We pray for all our federal, state, and local officials that you will protect them and bless them with wisdom and that they will guide the affairs of our nation, states, counties, and cities with wisdom, humility, unity, and submission to your will expressed in your holy word so that your church may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Lord, grant that our leaders impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain wickedness and crime, and protect the Christian church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we pray for Christ Church worldwide. Give grace to all bishops, presbyters, deacons, evangelists, and teachers, that by the godly conduct of their lives and the purity of their teaching, they may proclaim and demonstrate your true life-giving word, and rightly and duly administer the sacraments of the Lord's Supper and baptism. We pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world who are suffering because they are identified with the name of your Holy Son, Jesus Christ. Strengthen them to endure the persecution. Change the hearts and minds of the men and women who are persecuting your church, or remove them from power if they refuse to repent. To all people worldwide who confess and believe on the name of Jesus Christ, we ask that all of us may hear, receive, and obey with reverent and obedient hearts your holy word and commandments, and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Father, we also pray for all those who proclaim and teach the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world, that you will strengthen and encourage them to fulfill the Great Commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them, and teaching them to obey your commandments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Gracious Father, we ask in Jesus' name that in your goodness you will heal all who are sick in their body, mind, or spirit, and that you will provide abundant resource to meet the financial needs of saints who cry out to you for help, and that you will deliver all saints who are oppressed by the enemy and his agents in this world, and that you will encourage and uplift all saints throughout the world who are downcast and depressed. May they experience your joy and peace again. We pray for all unborn babies that they will be protected in their mother's wombs. Safely keep them away from murderous abortionists and change the hearts and minds of mothers and fathers who are contemplating aborting their unborn children. Let the babies live so that they may enjoy life you have planned for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we prepare our hearts to receive the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, let each of us, you and me, confess to Almighty God our individual sins and ask forgiveness of our transgressions against the holy commandments of His kingdom.
Most merciful Heavenly Father, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in His great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to Him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now hear the word of God. To all who truly turn to Jesus Christ, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Welcome back to the worship service here of New Zion Assembly. And we're so grateful that you have taken time out of your very busy schedule to join together with people from around the world, both by video and audio, worshiping the Lord Almighty together. And we take this portion of our service each week to recognize the command that Jesus gave to us. And He gave us this sacrament of faith, the Lord's Supper, to honor His death, burial, and resurrection until He comes again on the final day. Now, in our message today, we talked about the foolish man and the choices that the foolish man made. The primary foolish thing that the fool did was building his house upon sand. And we read in this passage, he had a great house. It stood up against the winds and the rains. It was sturdy. It survived life. But there comes a final beating, the end of time, where no house can stand unless it's built upon the solid rock. Now, I want to encourage you this week to take inventory of your spiritual life. You may have a great ministry. You may have a great testimony. You may have what you consider a great relationship with the church and with the Lord. But I'm going to ask you to take a look at the foundation. I recently sold a home. And as you sell a home, you have to have an inspection. And here in Florida, they inspect everything. They inspect, the footing. They inspect the attic. They inspect everything. One thing that a lot of people may not realize that we have to deal with here in Florida are termites. And the termites get in at the base foundation of the house, because most houses here in Florida are built on concrete slabs. And they are pretty solid. You would say it's a solid rock.
termites get in at the place where the house and the foundation attach to each other. And if there are enough areas where there's damage, the house could eventually be condemned, even a newer house. And that's why we have to treat our houses here in Florida on a regular basis for termites and bugs at the foundation. Now, the illustration here, of course, is that it may appear that the foundation is secure, but looking at it, have the cares of life, have everything that has been allowed to come into our lives eaten away at the footing of the house that we've built, and great will be the fall of it. Take inventory this week. And one way that we do this is when we express our worship in the Lord's Supper, we should always take an evaluation of our heart's content and make sure there's nothing standing between us and the Lord as we participate in the Lord's Supper. Corinthians, Paul taught that if you take the Lord's Supper in vain, not considering the Lord's death and His resurrection, it does you no good. In fact, it could be a curse upon you. I don't want you to be cursed. If there's anything standing between you and the Lord, then I would say, wait until you're ready. But if you're clear in your conscience before the Lord, we invite you to participate in the Lord's Supper. If you've made a confession of faith in Jesus Christ and been baptized in water according to the Scriptures, you're welcome to participate in the Lord's Supper, the communion. Let's pray. Almighty God, in your tender mercy, you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He offered himself and made once for all time a perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted this remembrance of his passion and death, which he commanded us to continue until he comes again. So, Father, we ask you to bless and sanctify with your word and Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine that we may partake of his most blessed body and blood. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed once for all upon the cross.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. This is the bread of heaven. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for you. After supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you, preserve your body and soul to everlasting life. Drink the cup of salvation in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. And blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. This sacrament is the gift of God for the people of God. Feed on him by faith with thanksgiving that Christ died for you. Everybody, please join in our closing prayer.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son and our Savior, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of Christ and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out into the world to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. The river, now I fight life's fine, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I know He.
God bless you. Thank you for being with us this week at New Zion Assembly. We certainly hope that this digital church service is a blessing to you and your friends and family and everybody that you love. If you know somebody who isn't saved, but you know that the Holy Spirit is working on that man or woman's heart, why don't you share New Zion Assembly with them? It might be difficult to get them to go to a church service in a building, but it'll be a lot easier to get them to watch a digital church service in the privacy of their home and let the Word of God start getting inside them and let the Holy Spirit do His work. We love you very much. Thank you for being here. We'll see you next week. God bless.